I bet you didn't know that conic sections have superpowers. That's what we're talking about today. I mean, technically we're talking about applications of conic sections, but the reason we can apply them in so many ways is because of the superpowers that they possess. What superpower, Mr. Yantek, I'm sure you're asking? Well, let's take a quick peek. For the parabola, which we discussed first, right? The thing about a parabola is that any beam, it could be a beam of light, it could be a radio wave, it could be a satellite signal that enters the parabola parallel, right? Parallel to the axis right here of symmetry is going to have a property which it bounces off the parabola directly to, guess what? If you're thinking the focus, you are all over it. That is exactly right. So that is the power of the parabola, and we'll see how that gets used shortly. Next, we covered ellipses, right? The power of the ellipse is that any signal, once again, could be a beam of light reflecting off of something, an interior that's kind of shiny. It could be a ultrasound or some kind of pulse reflecting off of a wall. But anything that leaves one focus is going to bounce directly toward the other focus, no matter where it hits. So if it hits there, it's going to do it. If it's over here, bam, it's going to do it. And so anything leaving one focus will end up being refracted directly to the other focus. That's the power of the ellipse. Remember, those two distances will always add up to a constant sum. That's the definition of the ellipse. And then finally, the hyperbola, it's kind of similar to the ellipse, except this time we're outside of the shape. And if we're moving toward one focus, we'll bounce off the exterior of the hyperbola directly towards the focus of the other. So each of these has kind of a superpower, which allows them to be applied in different ways. They also are connected with science, especially the ellipses and hyperbolas, because of the gravitational nature of matter. And we'll see a couple examples that get into that too. So let's start right off with the parabolas. This is a satellite dish, and they build these satellite dishes very very carefully into a parabolic form, a parabolic shape, so that they can then put the receiver, this is the receiving element right here, right where the focus should be. So, this beam is coming in. Now it'd have to be parallel to the line of symmetry, the axis of symmetry. So I'll go ahead and throw one in here. So let's say this is the axis of symmetry right here, going right through the middle of this parabolic dish. And so here comes, signal number one from outer space. But boom, what's going to happen? Well, it's going to get directed off of the dish straight to the receiver. This one comes in, but boom. Where is it going to get directed? Right to the receiver, right? If we didn't have this property, there would only be certain signals, like this guy right here, would be the only one actually hitting the receiver, right? That would be a really weak signal. But luckily, any signal that hits inside of the dish is going to end up getting diverted back to the receiver. And that's why you can see the cord coming out of the receiver. That's why we get a strong signal coming out of that dish. Here's some pictures of the same idea, where you have incoming signals. They are parallel to the axis, and you can see they all bounce right back to the signal source, bam, here, or here, okay? This is why when somebody puts a dish on a house, it has to be put at a very specific angle, because we have to ensure that those signals coming in from out of space are coming in most of them at least, at a parallel direction to the axis. Otherwise, it's going to be not receiving very good signal strength, because those signals are going to be bouncing off and missing the focus. That's why when they come out, they have to really set it up at a proper angle, and they know what it is and how to do that. So I guess that's why they work for dish. Anyway, here is an example where we could use this property. We're talking about the sidelines of a televised football game for the FBTV network, which I don't think really exists. And somebody has a parabolic reflector with a microphone. We're told that it's 3 feet across and 1 feet deep, and we're asked how far should the microphone be placed into the dish so that it's at the place where the focus is. Because that's where everything is going to be bouncing towards. It's going to be bouncing towards that focus, right? So first of all, let's visualize what this means. What is a parabolic microphone? So you've probably seen these if you've watched any sporting events. This dude's holding one, and it's just a little mini thing, but you can record a lot of sounds from the field. It'll really amplify those sounds, because once again, the signals are coming in, boom, boom, and bouncing right towards the receiver, which is at the focus. They put the microphone there on these things. It picks up a much stronger signal. Here's what we're going to do to do this. You can either do a vertical or a horizontal parabola. It really is up to you. To me, just because it kind of makes sense to go with what the picture was saying, I'm actually going to do a horizontally oriented picture. And so I'm going to put the vertex right at 0, 0. That just makes my equation so much easier. That makes my equation just, if it's horizontal, it would be what, y squared, and k would be 0 equals 4p, and then x. I don't have to write x minus h, because remember, h and k are both 0 if we put the vertex right at the origin. Now, I know that this parabolic reflector is 3 feet across. So if I went up 3 feet, actually, I guess it would only be 1.5 feet, right? So that would be, well, I think I'm going to go by halves. I'm going to say this is 0.5, and this is 0.5, just so this fits a little bit better. So if I went 1.5 feet up, so 1.5, and 1.5 feet down, -1.5, that would be the width of the parabola that they talked about. And then it's 1 foot deep. So they're telling us that, you know, it goes out 1 foot. So this would be one right here. So this is a point on the parabola, and this is a point on the parabola. Now, this is just a two-dimensional parabola here, and we got to understand that, that worked really well there. That was awful. I'm going to try that again. I think I'll try it. Maybe using something a little thicker so that it... it's easier to write. There we go. It's a little bit better. Now remember, this is a two-dimensional parabola, so I would actually have to rotate this, kind of like, say, pretend it came out toward us and then rotate it all the way around that way. It would trace out a dish, and that's what we're talking about. Okay. But here's the key, all right? If I'm gonna figure out where the focus is, let's grab a star for the focus. If I'm going to figure out where the focus is, where is it, right? How far from the vertex should it be? I need to figure out the p value, because the focus is always p units away from the vertex. It's also p units away from the directrix, right? But we don't really worry about the directrix right now. Somewhere back here is a directrix. We don't need that for this problem. But the focus, we need to figure it out. Well, luckily, I have two points that are actually on this shape. And one of those points is the point 1.5. You could call it 3/2 if you wanted. You could call it 1.5. It's really up to you. And we have you know, negative 1.5 or negative 3/2. And so I have two xy values based on the information they gave me that I know have to be on the equation of this parabola. So we're just going to play a little substitution game where it looks like I'm going to put 3/2 in for y and 4p1 in for x, right? So that's not going to really change anything over there. So I'm going to get 9/4 equals 4p. And when I divide by 4, or maybe it's easier with fractions to multiply by 1/4, it looks like we get 9/16 of a, we were in feet, right? So 9/16 of a feet. So that focus should be put 9/16 of a foot. So 8/16 is exactly half a foot. 8/16 is exactly, would be right here. We're talking about going just a little further than that. So that's where we should be. You could figure what that is in inches by just multiplying 9/16 by 12, and that would tell you roughly how many inches to go out. I guess I could do that for you. All right, thanks. Let's pause you for a second while I open the calculator up. So if we did 9/16 and multiplied that by 12 inches, what would it give us? About 6.75, I guess, inches is what we'd be looking at. All right. But anyway, that's how you do this first problem. Ellipses are the next one we'll talk about. The surface formed by rotating an ellipse around its focal axis. So once again, we're taking a two-dimensional ellipse and we're gonna rotate it and turn it into a three-dimensional, kind of, it'll look like a little football or a pill or something like that. So I actually tried to find like an animation for you to see this, because I know it's, for some people, it's hard to visualize how that actually happens, but I couldn't find any animations. I did find this picture of an ellipse that was along the x-axis, and it got spun around the x-axis, and you can see it kind of traced out into a three-dimensional object. And so that's what we mean by a three-dimensional ellipsoid. But let's look at the problem. It says the ellipse used to generate the ellipsoid of a lithoptera has a major axis of 12 feet and a minor axis of 5. How far from the center should it be? So I guess we want to know what a lithoptera is, right? And it talks about it up here. It's a healthcare device used if you're trying to avoid surgery to kind of break down kidney stones. And it'll shoot these high frequency waves in the direction of where the kidney stone is once they have a location. And it just kind of keeps bombarding it with these ultrasound waves and trying to break it up into little chunks. I've never had a kidney stone, but I've heard it's among the most painful things that are out there. So anyway, here's a picture of one. And this dude's kind of sitting there, and they're moving this device around so they can focus it on the exact location. You can see that over here they've got his kidneys there, and they found it probably with like an MRI or something, and now they're going to go and get it, right? Here's some other pictures. That lady's getting ready to have the same procedure. Let's see here. So remember, the idea is we send a pulse from one focus, right? And it goes directly to the other focus. So the way that they build these things is they have the part of the machine that sends the pulse located where one focus would be. and then they put the specific location of the kidney stone where the other focus should be, and that creates the pulses, the maximum effect of those pulses hitting where they're supposed to be hitting. You can see where we could actually, you know, create this ellipse right here. And that's the framework that we're trying to work within. All right. Here's another picture where we have the electrode, which is sending those pulses, and you can see they're bouncing off the surface, and we know where they're going to go. They're going to go directly to the other focus, which is where they have located that that kidney stone. We're just trying to break it down. And here, once again, is the ellipse with, you know, focus number one, focus number two, and that's the superpower of the ellipse. So hopefully you understand a little bit more now about what that device is. Let's go ahead and answer this question. It's actually not too bad. I mean, it tells us that the major axis, let's just make the horizontal axis the major axis. So it'll be x squared over a squared plus y squared over b squared. We'll center it at zero. And we don't know that yet. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 units out in either direction will give us a total distance of 12 units. Also notice that the minor axis has a total distance of 5. So that would be 2.5 up and 2.5 down. So this would be our ellipse. Now, knowing that the major axis is 12, that means A is 6. Half of 5 is what, 2.5 or 5/2. And we need to find C. C is the magic location where we want to center the electrode sending the pulses in the kidney stone, right? That's how far we want to be from the center to find those foci. So let's use our ellipse equation, a squared minus b squared equals c squared. Plug in a and b and do a little squaring and subtracting, and it looks like around 5.45 feet away. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 would be right about there. So that's the distance that we want to be from the center. And that's really all there is to that problem. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, Yancey, I thought ellipses were all about cooler things like, you know, elliptical orbits. And you're right. Kepler found that planets and actually anything in a gravitational field will not orbit in a circular orbit, but actually in an elliptical orbit, where the large mass which is creating the gravity, which keeps it in orbit, is actually not at the center, but indeed one of the foci itself. You can see little poor little Pluto that's not a planet way out in that blue orbit, right? And it's so elliptical that sometimes it actually cuts inside of Neptune. Watch that, boom, just cut inside. It's actually closer to the sun now than Neptune. So let's talk astronomy for a couple minutes. Kepler's first law of planetary motion is the path of a planet's orbit is an ellipse with the sun as one of the foci. And then they give us some definitions, perihelion, aphelion, and they come from the Greek. The Greeks gave us so much. Helios was the Greek word for sun. Apo meant far, peri meant near. And so peri means near, helion, helios, right, sun. So that is the closest that you ever come to the sun, nearest to the sun. And the aphelion, the aphelion is going to be apo, far from helios, sun, aphelion, far from sun. And we can figure these out very, very easily, these formulas, because we know that the distance all the way to the major vertex is A, right? And we know that the distance to the focus, which in this case is the sun, is C. So the furthest that we're ever going to be from the sun is going to be A plus C. That aphelion will always be A plus C. On the other hand, the closest I'm ever going to come to the sun is going to be this distance right here, which we can get by doing A minus C. So as long as you know A and C, you can actually determine these values very easily. And that's what we're going to do in this example. Let's go ahead and read the nitty-gritty here, which I think is the actual problem. Earth's orbit has a semi-major axis of about 149.598 gigameters and an eccentricity of about 0.0167. We need to find B and C in the perihelion and aphelion. That's what we need to determine in this problem. You may be asking, what is a gigameter? That is actually a pretty good question. I believe that it's a million meters. I guess we could, ask Google really quickly, right? What is a gigameter? A gigameter is the length of the International System of Units, which is 10 to the ninth. So yeah, I think that 10 to the ninth is indeed a million. Actually, nine zero might be. Might be more than that, nine zeros, huh? Yeah, it's actually, so a million would be right there. So it's actually a billion. So a billion meters is a gigameter. So that's not a short amount of distance, is it? Anyway, those are the units we're going to be measuring in for these astronomy problems because those distances are so vast. So gigameter, a billion meters. You may be wondering where some of these values come from, and you can look them up online any time, but actually in the book where you do some problems out of the textbook, there's a chart that has all the A values for each planet and all the eccentricities for each planet. So I think you'll have a couple of those to work on tonight, but that's where these numbers came from. So we know eccentricity is C over A, and they gave us the eccentricity, and they gave us the A value, right? And so all we need to do is multiply both sides of this by 149.598 to figure out the C value. Once I know the C value, I now know two of the primary values, A, B, and C. I can plug them in, let my calculator go to work, and figure out that the B value is going to be 149.577. So they asked me to find B and C. We did it. They also asked me to find the perihelion and the aphelion, and we've now done that because, well, we haven't done it, but we know the formulas, right? The perihelion is going to be that closest point, so we're going to take the A value they've given us, 149.598, and subtract the C value we found, and then the aphelion, we're going to add them together instead. That's the furthest point. And you can see these two numbers are actually fairly close together because the Earth's orbit is fairly circular. If those were really far away, we'd have a much more elliptical orbit. So that is how you do a question like this. You're just using some formulas. What is that? Wow. Oh, it's a comet. Yes, it turns out that comets also have orbits. And probably one of the most famous of all is Halley's Comet, which has an orbit of about every 76-ish years, I think. 76, 77 years it comes back. Look at the planetary orbits. Look so circular there. And then Halley's Comet is very, very elliptical. But the sun is the one of the way out close to the vertex focuses on that orbit. This next problem, though, is a little more bizarre than this because what it is talking about is an orbit that comes around the sun and then just shoots off. This shape right here shouldn't be reminding you too much, right, of of an ellipse. It should be reminding you a lot more of something. Yeah, there we go. That's something we can find, right? Something else that we studied, maybe a parabola, or in this case, we're actually talking about a hyperbola. So this is a hyperbolic orbit, which is something that is only recently been confirmed. Back in 2017, an object was discovered that was believed to be a comet that was on this trajectory. And so it kind of freaked people out because they're like, well, if it's on a hyperbolic orbit, that means that it's not coming back. And so this is something that we would call an interstellar object, an interstellar comet. In this case, it turned out to be not a comet, but an asteroid. So hyperboloid of revolution is what we talked about earlier, where if it bounces off the surface, if it's leaning towards one focus, it'll bounce directly towards the other focus, right? So this is the this is that superpower of hyperbolas. But we don't even need that superpower to answer this question. That's kind of talking about this situation where we're moving towards one focus, we bounce off and move straight towards the other one. We don't need that one. We're really more talking about just the property of the equation. And this is your typical elliptical orbit around the star, right? But we're talking today about what if it's kind of a crazy orbit like that. And so that's what this talks about, a celestial body that is traveling within a gravitational field of a much more massive body follows a path that is closely approximated by a conic section of the more massive body. In theory, a comet can approach the sun from interstellar space and make a partial loop around the sun and then leave the solar system. So this is called an interstellar object. Okay, and this textbook, I think, was published in the early 2000s. That's the textbook where these problems came from. And I think at the time it was a theory, okay? But that picture I showed you from 2017 was something that confirmed that these things actually do exist. And here it is, right here. It came in. You can see the date up at the top, 2017. We're going through the summer months. There's the sun. It came around, passed by Mercury, came a little bit close to Earth, and then boom, there it was, gone again. And we'll never see that again. It's never coming back to our solar system, okay? So that is the object that they found back in 2017 and followed it. So this was the first confirmed interstellar object that, and it's probably, surely not the only one there's ever been. It's just the first one that we as humans are able to actually follow and find. This is a picture of it. It's a crazy looking object, and they thought it was a comet, but it didn't have the ice in the tail. They found it in an observatory in Hawaii. So named it with a Hawaiian word, muamua, which in Hawaiian means scout, so scouting out our solar system from the depths of outer space. Because of its weird shape, it's often compared to like a cigar shape. There's been a lot of, you know, interesting theories out there that it's not really an asteroid. It's really a weird alien spaceship that is spying on us. I'm not so sure about that. But it did have some interesting properties. First of all, it was not on the ecliptic plane, which most of the planets exist on. It actually came kind of from above the plane and then looped down below that sun and then back up. Now notice that if you tried to do an axis of symmetry here, the focus would probably be more like around there. So we wonder why the sun is a focus is just a little bit off on this. And I think it's because you got all these other planets, especially some of the big ones like Venus and Saturn and Neptune, which are also pulling this thing with their gravitation And so I think that's why you don't get the perfect hyperbolic spot where the sun is the only gravitational force at exactly the focus. Okay. But anyway, yeah, speculation has been around for a long time. In 2008, they thought they found a comet. You can see it right down here that was from out of the solar system, that was in our solar system, but they weren't able to confirm it. As it says, for generations, we have wondered whether comets originated, all of them were here, or they came from outside. But even though they saw this one, they couldn't confirm its path. This is from a long time ago, and they actually had this is Wikipedia had an article on interstellar comets specifically. And here's an example of one they said was an interstellar comet. But the truth is they didn't have the data. This is all the way from back in the 90s. And so if you go to the same page today, they don't call it interstellar comets. They call it interstellar objects because they now have the Oumuamua that we just discussed, which was not a comet. And then they did find the first ever comet, the second interstellar object just last year, just around Christmas time. I think it was discovered by a Russian astronomer, Borisov, and so it was named after him. You can see the exact same pictures being used in this article, but notice that now they say this comet, Hayakutake, I think is how you say that, might be an interstellar object captured by the solar system, okay? So that means that it actually caught it and kept it in its gravitational field. Here is that Borisov comet, and then this is the brightest picture of it because it had been taken right after it had reached its perihelion, so it just looped around the sun, and it was moving so fast at that point in time. In fact, they clocked it at 100,000 miles an hour. That there's no way at that speed that the solar system is going to hold on to it. So that comet is heading back to deep space. It's going to be out amongst the nothingness between solar systems and stars for a while until some other star grabs it with its gravitational pull. Interesting to think that this thing for millions, possibly billions of years is floating through space in the coldest possible conditions where almost nothing exists. And then it came so close to our sun that it was the hottest it may have ever been when this picture was taken. But anyway, let's do this problem. This problem, I'm not gonna lie to you, is more complex, but I will tell you this. The system I'm about to show you to solve it is gonna work on the other two in your homework and would work on any problems like this. They're very, very systematic. So this is how you do it. We are going to set our center and a really nice, easy place to work with, right at zero. So that means we don't have to worry about H and K, okay? Here comes our comet right here, okay? And it's going to come through its orbit. Here is the perihelion, here's the sun, right? So there's the focus. And then it's going to shoot back off into space. So that is the path of this comet. Now, here's what they told us in the problem. Here's the information they're giving us. The first thing is that the perihelion is 90 gigameters, 90. So remember, that's the closest it ever comes. That's this value right here. But it's also what we know is C minus A. Notice it's not A minus C because we're now in hyperbola. If it was an ellipse, it would be A minus C, but in a hyperbola, C is bigger than A. So C minus A becomes the perihelion. We are also told that when the sun is perpendicular to the comet on the focal axis. So here comes the comet. When it gets to a point where it's directly perpendicular to the sun on that focal axis, right? It is 281.25 gigameters. So this is 281.25. Now, I'm going to tell you that distance. It is b squared divided by a. Okay? That's just one of these relationships, and I'll explain it to you in a second, but you really just kind of have to memorize that if you want to do this type of problem. Like I said, it's not a, like you're going to see a ton of these problems, but if you want to do this type of problem, you're really going to have to know that relationship. Okay, and so those are the two pieces of information they give us. Now, because this is a hyperbola, I also know that a squared plus b squared is equal to c. All right, that's for true for any hyperbola. So I have three variables, a, b, and c. I need to weasel this down to just one variable so that I can solve for the variable. So I notice I have a's in both of these two equations. I'm going to solve for c in terms of a. I'm going to solve for b squared in terms of a, and that's going to allow me to make some substitutions. That's really how this is going to work. Okay, so easy enough to solve in terms of a for the first equation. We're just going to add a to the other side. So now we know what c is equal to, a plus 90. On this one, the opposite of dividing by a is multiplying by a. So I'm just going to multiply both sides by a. So b squared is equal to 281.25a. So now I can come to that third equation, right? A squared plus b squared plus c squared, and make some substitutions. Instead of b squared, I'm just going to write 281.25a. Now notice I don't even have to square it anymore because that is b squared already. So it's not like it's just b and I have to put it in and square it. So that's a really nice substitution. Now c squared is going to be a plus 90 squared. That one is a little bit of a pain because we do have to FOIL it out. Don't just think it's a squared plus 8100. You'll miss the middle term and you'll get the problem wrong. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and do that for you. A squared plus 180a plus 8100. Right. Now notice that the a's here, right, cancel out. The a squareds go away. So now I can just subtract this 180a from both sides. Let's get rid of that, right? We'll subtract that. And now I just need to divide by 101.25. And there's your answer for A. A is 80 gigameters. So you can see that what started as a really crazy looking problem, if we just set up the couple relationships we have and make some substitutions, it's not too bad algebraically to solve for A. And the great news is once you solve for A, you just fly through the rest of the problem. For example, we know from the first equation, right, that c is equal to a plus 90. So if a is 80, then c is 80 plus 90, or 170 gigameters. Okay. We also know that b squared is 281.25 times a. So if I put in 80 for a there, I get 22,500. And then, of course, I have to take the square root of that. This won't happen often, but in this case, it's a perfect square. 22,500 is exactly the square, is taking the square root of is exactly 150. So now we have A and B and C, and the only thing left to find, I think, they wanted us to find A, B, C, and the eccentricity. The eccentricity. So the eccentricity, remember, is C over A, which we have is 170 and 80, so 17 eighths, or if you want to reduce that, 2.125. Remember, anytime the eccentricity is greater than one, we're dealing with a hyperbola. Anytime the eccentricity is less than one, we're dealing with an ellipse. Now, it did want us to find the coordinates of the center of the sun, but we know that the sun is at the focus, and we just found, right, that C is 170, so I think that's just going to be 170, zero. So that's what's going to happen. Comet's going to come around. It's going to get as close as 90 gigameters, and then it's going to loop back out and leave the solar system. Phew, and there it goes, never coming back, especially if it's traveling 100,000 miles an hour. So the last thing I'll talk about briefly is this piece right here, right? Really, if you want to do these kinds of problems, you just have to remember that that half the focal distance is b squared over a, half the focal width. Why is that the case, right? Why is y is half the focal width, b squared over a. So this is in the notes, and it walks you through. This is kind of small writing, so let's blow that up here on the screen and go through this process, okay? I'm going to write the equation of this hyperbola. I centered it at 0, 0, so that means h and k are 0, so it's just going to be x squared, y squared. Because it's a horizontally positioned ellipse, it's going to be at positive x squared, negative y squared. So this is our formula, x squared over a squared minus y squared over b squared, right? Now let's think about what we know. We know that this point, when it is perpendicular to the focal axis, when it is on that focal width line, is going to be the same x value over as the focus. It's going to be c values over. We don't know how far up it is. We don't. So I'm just going to leave that. It's just a y, right? It's just y. So I'm going to go ahead and substitute c for the x value. And that's really the only change I can make here. There's not much else I know how to do to change this equation. But I do know that c squared is equal to a squared plus b squared. That's our tip, that's our classic hyperbola relationship. And then I can break that fraction up into a squared over a squared, b squared over a squared. Of course, a squared over a squared is just 1, right? So that's awesome. And the one on the left and the one on the right are just going to cancel. This one and this one, those are just going to go away. So all I really end up with at that point is this stuff right here left on this side, and then nothing left on the other side. These ones are canceled, so now I just have this. So I'm gonna add the y squared over b squared to the other side to make it positive. And now I've created what we call a proportion, right? One ratio set equal to another ratio. And the classic way of solving proportions is to cross multiply. And so b squared times b squared is b to the fourth. A squared times y squared is a squared y squared. I'm trying to solve for y, if you remember. I want to know how far away this point is from the focus point. What is this distance right here, right? So I'm trying to solve for y. So I'm going to go ahead and divide by a squared to get y squared isolated, but it is y squared, so I need to take the square root, and look what we get. We get the square root of b to the fourth over a squared. Those are both perfect squares. Square root of b to the fourth is b squared, and the square root of a squared is a, and there's your b squared over a, just like we promised. Don't forget to do plus or minus, because we did take an even root, square root, right? And that makes sense to me that it's plus or minus, because we have a point up here that has that distance, but we have another point down here that has that same distance. So positive distance up, negative distance down. So you don't really need to understand this to be able to do the problem. You just have to know that fact that I gave you, b squared over a. But now you know the reasoning behind that. So this assignment is going to consist of about, I don't know, 10 or 12 application problems. And they're all going to be very similar to these problems that we just went over. So please use these notes. I have them all worked out on the calendar on a PDF to do them. The problems from Section 8.1 are going to deal with the parabolas. From 8.2, we're going to deal with ellipses, and some of them may be, like the Lichter-Crypter problem, but a lot of them are just astronomy problems. And then finally, 55 and 56 are just like that long problem we just finished with. Just set up the same exact system of substitutions, and you will be fine, all right? So thanks for hanging with me today as we did some applications. I hope your Thursday's going all right. You're almost made it to spring break, and I'm going to throw these up here as we go out so that you can kind of be checking to see that your answers are working out. I know that you have the odds in the back, but this will give you all of them. I'll be around this afternoon at 3, right, for questions, tomorrow at 3. And then you got break, and we'll take a week off and chill. So take care, and hope everybody's doing all right. Thank you.
Yeah.